An economic bubble is trade in an asset at a price or price range that strongly deviates from the corresponding asset's intrinsic value. It could also be described as a situation in which asset prices appear to be based on implausible or inconsistent views about the future. Because it is often difficult to observe intrinsic values in real-life markets, bubbles are often conclusively identified only in retrospect. When a sudden drop in prices appears, such a drop is known as a crash or a bubble burst. Both the boom and the burst phases of the bubble are examples of a positive feedback mechanism, in contrast to the negative feedback mechanism that determines the equilibrium price under normal market circumstances. Prices in an economic bubble can fluctuate erratically and become impossible to predict from supply and demand alone. While some economists deny that bubbles occur, the cause of bubbles remains disputed by those who are convinced that asset prices often deviate strongly from intrinsic values. Many explanations have been suggested, and research has recently shown that bubbles may appear even without uncertainty, speculation, or bounded rationality. In such cases, the bubbles may be argued to be rational, where investors at every point fully compensated for the possibility that the bubble might collapse by higher returns. These approaches require that the timing of the bubble collapse can only be forecast probabilistically, and the bubble process is often modeled using a Markov switching model. It has also been suggested that bubbles might ultimately be caused by processes of price coordination or emerging social norms. Origin of term. The term bubble, in reference to financial crisis, originated in the 1711 to 1720 British South Sea Bubble, and originally referred to the companies themselves and their inflated stock, rather than to the crisis itself. This was one of the earliest modern financial crises. Other episodes were referred to as manias, as in the Dutch tulip mania. The metaphor indicated that the prices of the stock were inflated and fragile, expanded based on nothing but air, and vulnerable to a sudden burst, as in fact occurred. Some later commentators have extended the metaphor to emphasize the suddenness, suggesting that economic bubbles end all at once and nothing first, just as bubbles do when they burst. Though theories of financial crises such as debt deflation and the financial instability hypothesis suggest instead that bubbles burst progressively, with the most vulnerable assets failing first, and then the collapse spreading throughout the economy. Impact. The impact of economic bubbles is debated within and between schools of economic thought. They are not generally considered beneficial, but it's debated how harmful their formation and bursting is. Within mainstream economics, many believe that bubbles cannot be identified in advance, cannot be prevented from forming, that attempts to prick the bubble may cause financial crisis, and that instead authorities should wait for bubbles to burst of their own accord, dealing with the aftermath via monetary policy and fiscal policy. Within Austrian economics, economic bubbles are generally considered to have a negative impact on the economy because they tend to cause misallocation of resources into non-optimal users. This forms the basis of Austrian business cycle theory. Political economist Robert E. Wright argues that bubbles can be identified before the fact with high confidence. In addition, the crash which usually follows an economic bubble can destroy a large amount of wealth and cause continuing economic malaise. This view is particularly associated with the debt deflation theory of Irving Fisher, and elaborated within post-Keynesian economics. A protracted period of low risk premiums can simply prolong the downturn in asset price deflation, as was the case of the Great Depression in the 1930s for much of the world and the 1990s for Japan. Not only can the aftermath of a crash devastate the economy of a nation, but its effects can also reverberate beyond its borders. Effect upon spending. Another important aspect of economic bubbles is their impact on spending habits. Market participants with overvalued assets tend to spend more because they feel richer. Many observers quote the housing market in the United Kingdom, Australia, New Zealand, Spain, and parts of the United States in recent times as an example of this effect. When the bubble inevitably bursts, those who hold on to these overvalued assets usually experience a feeling of reduced wealth and tend to cut discretionary spending at the same time, hindering economic growth or, worse, exacerbating the economic slowdown. In an economy with a central bank, the bank may therefore attempt to keep an eye on asset price appreciation and take measures to curb high levels of speculative activity in financial assets. This is usually done by increasing the interest rate. Austrians maintain that the central bank's interest rates, by overriding the natural savings-based market rate of interest, cause bubbles. Consumers spend more and save less, either induced by reduced savings account rates or forced by virtue of inflation, or they borrow to support increased present consumption, but this pulls consumption forward in time rather than achieving a sustainable increase. Meanwhile, the low interest rates translate into reduced cost of capital and improved debt service coverage to finance an investment, and there is an increase in investment in the capacity to produce. This investment, of course, requires an increased future level of consumption in order to be profitable, but as we know, consumption, since it is being maintained by reduction of savings or borrowing, must be reduced in the future. In the short run, there is an increase in employment in both retail and the booming sector, be it construction in the 2000s or oil in the 2010s. But eventually the disconnect between supply and demand over time manifests itself, typically along with rising prices and/or rising interest rates. The malinvestment is a waste of capital, and the employment is a waste of personal capital in skill sets and experience for which demand is not sustainable.